Hello students, in this video lecture we are going to study about transcription in eukaryotes. In the previous lecture we had seen about the process of prokaryotic transcription, and in this video lecture we are going to study about eukaryotic transcription. If we see both this diagram, we'll find that there are some additional steps and some complexities in terms of eukaryotic transcription. In eukaryotic transcription, after the process of transcription, we would be having mRNA, which would be pre-mRNA, not the mature mRNA. For getting mature, the pre-mRNA has to go through many processes, which are like splicing, polyadenylation, and capping. And after that, we would be having mature mRNA, which would be able to produce proteins. So now we'll start. In terms of prokaryotes, we have seen that there is only one RNA polymerase which was able to transcribe for all the RNA in the cell. On the other hand, when we see in terms of eukaryotes, they have three different polymerases, each transcribing a different class of RNA. And the processing of transcripts is also more complex in eukaryotes. In eukaryotes, the three different RNA polymerases are as follows. Polymerase 1, which is responsible for the transcription of rRNAs. Polymerase 2, which is responsible for transcription of mRNA. And then polymerase 3, which is responsible for the transcription of tRNA, 5S rRNA, and remaining snRNAs. Eukaryotic RNA polymerase are hard to study as they are low in concentration. And all the eukaryotic RNA polymerase have multiple subunits. So if we see this table reveals that there are two more polymerases, but those two polymerases are present in plant, not in eukaryotes. So we would be studying about these three only in terms of eukaryotic RNA polymerases. And after this polymerase, we would be shifting our focus onto the second thing, that is promoter. Promoter is that region where the entire mechanism starts. So in terms of eukaryotic mechanism, we would be having two types of promoter sites. One would be our core promoter sites, and second would be our proximal promoter site, which would be somewhat far from the starting point. But when we see core promoter, it initiates a pyrimidine rich sequence, and along with that, it has a Tata box, which is around minus 25 to 30 base pairs upstream. It is known as Tata element or Goldberg-Hoeganis box. And when we see proximal promoter elements, we would be having CAD box, that is around minus 75 to minus 80, and then GC box, which is somewhat minus 90 to minus 100. And if we see this diagram, here we can easily see we are having the structure of a eukaryotic gene, where we are having Tata box, we are as core promoter, and we are having our CAD box and GC box as our proximal control elements. And if we go further, we'll find that in eukaryotes, apart from promoter site, there are some different sites which are known as enhancers. These are distinct sites which are present far away from the promoter region, but are still able to control the rate of transcription. And on those enhancer sites, there are some proteins which comes and binds to these enhancer sites, which are known as activators. Activators are those proteins which come and sit on enhancer, and then it controls the rate of transcription. And after that, since we have already spoken of activators, they are the promoters important in transcription regulation, and they are recognized by promoter proximal elements. And enhancers contain short sequence elements, some more similar to promoter sequences, but they are very, very far. And after that, RNA polymerase is not having any sigma factor which would guide it to the correct position. So how it is done? So for that, there are general transcription factors on core promoter. There are varieties of transcription factors which come and which sit at the correct position and guides RNA polymerase to get bind to the correct position. So there are many transcription factors which comes one by one and add up to the process. These are few transcription factors in eukaryotes: TF2E, TF2A, TF2F, TF2D, TBP, TF2B, TF2H. This name is the nomenclature of it. It's like transcription factor 2 is for the polymerase. If these are the transcription factors for polymerase 3, the nomenclature would have been TF3E. So on the basis of polymerase, the nomenclature differs. And if we see this diagram is having a deep knowledge of assembly of transcription initiation machinery. We see there we have TF2D, it is having TBP, that is starter box binding protein, and there are many transcription factors which come and sit here on the Tata box. Since TF2D would come and it would sit on Tata box, it would initiate the binding of TF2A and TF2B. Once these things binds to Tata box, TF2F takes RNA polymerase with it and it comes to the Tata box and finds the correct position where transcription machinery has to start. And after that, TF2E and TF2H also joins the complex and makes the transcription initiation complex. This complex goes around and complete the process. And since we have reached to the midpoint of the process, now we'll see how eukaryotic mRNA looks like. This is the structure of mRNA. Here we have at the 5' end, we have untranslated leader sequence, which is a point for the translation starting. And after that, we have protein coding sequence and followed by translation stop and 3' untranslated trailer sequences. And now we'll see some more differences. In prokaryotes, the RNA transcript is having no modification. And the transcription and translation are the coupled reactions in the cytoplasm. And the message may be polycystronic. On the other hand, when we see eukaryotes, they have to modify pre-RNA into mRNA by RNA processing. The processed mRNA migrates from nucleus to cytoplasm before translation. And messengers are always monocystronic. We see this diagram is a diagram of prokaryotic cell and eukaryotic cell. So we can see here, this is DNA template and there is RNA polymerase and there is mRNA. This mRNA is getting coupled with ribosome and they have started making proteins. The process is coupled here. On the other hand, when we see in terms of eukaryotes, this is DNA, this is nucleus, and once the process ends, then we have pre-mRNA. This is not the one which would be used for the production of protein. After this, the production of this pre-mRNA, this pre-mRNA would get into processing, that is 5' capping, 3' polyadenylation, and removal of intron. And then it would become mRNA, that is mature mRNA. And this mRNA would go into the cytoplasm and would start the reaction of protein making. Then, now we'll go into the modification. So at the 5' end and at the 3' end, there are different modifications. At 5' end, we have a capping. A capping enzyme adds a guanine, usually 7-methyl guanosine, to the 5' end with the 5' to 5' linkage. This linkage is very unique because all the linkages you have studied would be your 5' to 3', but this is the only linkage which is present at the 5' to 5'. And the cap is used for the ribosome binding to the mRNA during translation initiation. We see this diagram. This is our structure where we are having this structure guanine, and this is 5', and this is attached to other group with its 5' only. So here we can see 5' to 5' bond. This is unique bond. And hence, it makes sure that RNA is not degraded from 5' side. So it saves DNA, it saves RNA from getting degraded also. After this, we have one more process, that is polyadenylation, in which after a particular sequence, that is AAU AAA, poly A enzyme starts adding adenine at the 3' end. So the enzyme poly A polymerases adds a nucleotide to the 3' end of the RNA using ATP as substrate. So here we can see in this diagram, we have got our sequence, that is AAU and AAA. After this, endonuclease recognizes the sequence and cuts the mRNA to 11 to 30 nucleotide away. And when it makes a cut here, poly A polymerase would come here and start adding AAA at the 3' end. And it would add around 200 residues of adenine. And this would ensure that your 3' end is also safe. And after this, one very important process is in removal of intron. Introns are the part in genome which are non-coding, and they have to be removed, because when we go for translation, introns would not do anything. So they have to be removed from the process. So in this diagram, we can see Philip Liddell. He was the first person who found that mouse beta globulin pre-mRNA is collinear with the gene that encodes it, while the mature globin mRNA is shorter than the gene. Then they searched on it and they found that introns were missing in the mature mRNA. So they worked on it and they proved that intron removal is one very important mechanism which happens. So till now we have seen the processes. Transcription is done, addition of 5' cap is done, addition of poly A tail is done. Now the only part is left, that is splicing to remove introns. So if we see this diagram, it tells us better. Here we had DNA, and then DNA is converted to pre-mRNA, where we were having 5' cap and still we are having introns, exon, intron, exon, repeat, and then we have poly A tail. So RNA splicing is a process where introns are removed. So if we go further and we see this mRNA, so it would tell that protein coding sequence is there, not any other sequence. And it would go and make polypeptide with the reactions and in the process that is known as translation. And after that, we'll see introns typically begin with 5' GU and end with AG sequence at their 3' site. But mRNA splicing signal involves more than just these two signals. So spliceosomes are the small nuclear ribonuclear protein particles, also known as SNRNPs, associated with pre-mRNAs. Spliceosome principal SNRNAs are U1, U2, U4, U5 and U6. They have their unique functions and they are used in the removal of introns. U1 SNRNP binds at the 5' site, U2 binds at the 3' site, U4, U6 and U5 interact and then bind with U1 and U2, creating a loop, and U4 dissociates from the complex, forming an active spliceosome. And in this diagram, we will see we have RNA that is having exon 1, and this is GU at 5' site. And then we have intron, and we are having branch point adenine here. And then we have AG on our 3' site. So this is splice junction. It is known as splice junction. And U1 would come and it would bind to 5' site. And after U1, U2 would come and it would attach to the branch point, that is adenine. And after this, U4, U6 and U5 would come and it would join the complex and they would make a loop. And when the loop is formed, U4 is released from the system and this would make this spliceosome, the entire complex is known as spliceosome now. So this spliceosome becomes active, and when it becomes active, so they make cut here and here, and after that splicing occurs. So mature mRNA is having exon 1 and exon 2 and excise intron sequence in lariat shape, that is till complex with SNRPs, and at the last process release intron RNA in lariat shape, which would again go into the system and would get recycled, and then SNRNPs would go into the system. And this splicing process is very, very important. After this, we'll go to the next topic, that is alternative splicing. Have you ever wondered why our body is able to make so many antibodies, so many proteins, although we are not having more than 30,000 genes in our body, but we have proteins which are in lakhs? How is it possible? So to account this process, we have one more very important topic, that is alternative splicing or alternative RNA splicing or differential splicing. It is a regulated process during gene expression that results in a single gene coding for multiple proteins. How it is possible? For that, we'll see particular exons of a gene may be included within or excluded from the final processed messenger RNA produced from that gene. If we see this diagram here, we can see we are having exon 1, exon 2, exon 3, exon 4, and exon 5. It would translate into RNA 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then the actual picture starts to begin. Here we can see if it would take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this would become protein A. At the same time, if it takes 1, 2, 4 and 5, then the end product would be different. It is forming protein B. And if we see here, 1, 2, 3 and 5, again a different product, that is protein C. So how it is possible? It is very much possible in our system. And the entire process is called as alternative splicing. And this process is very important in making so many types of antibodies in our body. And how they are able to do it. So for that, if we go deep into this thing, so they change their position. Positions of what? Positions of cut and their poly A sites. By varying these things, they can have this alternative splicing. It was first discovered in 1981, and where they found that the gene encoding the thyroid hormone calcitonin, which was there in mammalian cell, is alternatively spliced. In one form, they got that this gene contains 6 exons. The calcitonin mRNA contains exon 1 to 4 and terminates after a polydenylation sites in exon 4. So it means out of those 6 exons, only 4 are there. At this second point, they found that another mRNA is produced from this pre-mRNA by skipping exon 4, and it goes like 1, 2, 3, 5 and 6, and it encodes for a protein known as calcitonin gene-related peptide. It means one another protein. So this is happening here. If we see this diagram, we can easily find that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6, since they have poly A sites at various positions, so they can shuffle it. Cleavage and polydenylation and at the thyroid part gives after splicing gives us mature mRNA translation protease action, and this would give calcitonin. On the same part, if we see the same primary transcript having different cleavage site and polydenylation in your neuron cells, that is in brain, it is having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 splicing occurs, and then mature mRNA is having 1, 2, 3, 5 and 6 translation occurs, protease action, and now we are having CGRP, a totally different sort of peptide chain. So alternative splicing is one very important phenomena, and it is in our body and it is very, very common there in the formation of different varieties of proteins. So thank you for listening to me. And if you have any doubt or any query, you can log on to our various digital platforms and let us know it, and feel free to contact us. Thank you and have a good day ahead.